So hello everyone, welcome to the energy efficiency thematic module organized by MedCities. This is the second session, as you know, which will be very focused on real examples. As I said, we kindly suggest you to modify your name and include the name of your municipality. And we also remind you that there is simultaneous translation available in French and in Arabic. If it bothers you, the background noise of the original language, you can mute it by pressing on the language options and pressing on mute original audio. Some of you have told us it was a bit bothering for you. So without further delay, I welcome you all. I hope you enjoy the second session, and I thank Berdiana and everyone here. So whenever you want, Berdiana, you can start.
Okay, thank you, Gemma. So good afternoon to all of you, and welcome again to this second session of these three sessions dedicated to energy efficiency in the Mediterranean cities. For people who did not attend the previous session, my name is Verdiana Russo and I'm talking from Barcelona. I am a building engineer and I work as a project manager in Antisis Lavola, which is a part of the Antisis group. It is an international sustainability consultancy company with offices in Europe, North America, Asia, Latin America, and Middle East. The objective of this today's session is to show different real cases in order to see real successful and replicable examples from Mediterranean cities to overcome challenges in energy efficiency. You will see that there will be a strict connection with the contents of session one. This session today will last about 2 hours too. And as you may know, these sessions are designed to promote the debate among attendees. So, and also to promote the exchange of experiences between Mediterranean cities. So I know that the virtual format is not so attractive like in person, but you are really invited to participate. You can do it by chat or by unmuting your microphone in every moment you want. Okay, so like in the previous session, at the end of the session, there will be a specific open turn in order to speak or to make questions, to give your opinions or impressions about the example that I will present here. But by the way, as I will go through different examples, I strongly invite you to ask, to stop me and to give feedback after each example, for example, okay? You can give comments, you can, or it is very interesting to understand if the applicability of these examples in your cities. And if you think that there is not an applicability, we can comment it and talk about it, okay? So just to start, a brief introduction with a reminder of the content of the session one. We just for people who was not here in this session last time, we talked about these 5 points. So an introduction on the state of the energy usage in Mediterranean cities. We talked about a bit about the importance of developing a sustainable energy action plan for a city. Then we talked about possible actions for energy transition and communication tools and financing sources. About this content, I know that Gemma for sure sent you the bibliography, or if she didn't, she will do it in the next days. So there will be a lot of information that you can read about. Okay, just remember, I think that this graphic is one of the most important ones because it is quite representative of the reality of the south countries of Mediterranean, and especially it refers to the aggregated emissions in a covenant of major south signatories, and it is by sectors and energy sources. And what we saw is that the majority of aggregated emissions, like 60%, comes from buildings, equipments, facilities, and industries. And within this group of sectors, residential buildings has a quite high, have the highest contribution. And it is important to also to see the sources. So the main source here in this area is electricity, but also natural gas and liquid gas. The other big sector with high emissions is transport, depending almost totally from diesel and gasoline. In the first session, we enter in detail in the possible actions that you can implement in your cities as a policy for energy efficiency. So we saw them in these different groups. So regarding municipal buildings, we talked about energy audits, building energy management systems and control system improvement. Then renovation, public building renovation, renewable energy production, efficient technology for heating and cooling, and the importance of consumer information and empowering, especially for people who work in municipal buildings. Then for private sector, the importance of boosting residential building renovation and renewable energy installation, and as well, a specific characteristic of Mediterranean countries, the engagement of the tourism sector in sustainable energy generation and the reduction of emissions. And we also saw the importance of working in promoting energy services, consumer information and empowering for citizens. Okay, then we talk about public lighting. That even if it's not one of, going back, it's not one of the main sector who with highest emissions, as you can see here, it is really important for a lot of Mediterranean countries, and it can be a good action for starting energy efficiency policies to make them more visible. To help to promote awareness for citizens and also for energy savings. Okay, so here we talked about energy audits and the modernization of public lighting with the replacement with LED technology. And then in the end, we talk about energy communities and joint actions and local business models. So having seen this previous context, I would like to ask you some feedback about that presentation of the first section, just to understand what content was most useful for you, and what would you like to deepen in future. Okay, so like last time, we have prepared a poll for you that will appear in your screen, and there are three questions. The first one is, what part of the content of session one did you find most useful for the needs for your city? Okay, and so it is divided into these five contents that I show you: the state of energy usage in Mediterranean cities, the sustainable energy action plan, possible action for energy transition, communication tools, and financing sources. Okay, so you can vote here, and then the second question will appear for you.
I just launched the first one.
Ah, okay, okay, okay. I thought they were all together. No, we can.
Yeah, no. So
we can wait a bit for people to answer. Thank you for your participation. Okay, it seems that okay, the most useful seems to be the clue, the clue content of the session that was about the possible actions, but also the introduction, okay, that made I think it was a way to understand the current situation of cities regarding energy efficiency and emissions, the connection of the energy transition needs with the problematic of energy emissions and the dependence on fossil fuels. Okay, and someone says also that you find useful the part of the content about sustainable energy action plan. Some cities were interested in this, and some other ones had already a plan. And also financing sources. Perhaps we didn't give so much time on financing sources. We could do a bit more, give a bit more space to them. But also communication tools. Okay, we saw that the Sustainable Energy Action Plan need for sure to be accompanied or connected with a communication plan in order to be more successful and effective. Okay, so 55% of the attendees have answered. Perhaps we can shift to the second one.
Okay.
Thank you. So the second, here is possible action for energy transition, okay. Okay, compartir lo resulta. I can share the result here. Perhaps you are seeing them. And then, Gemma, it says that I have to resend the votation or?
No, I do it. Okay. No, because I launched the second question. Huh?
Okay.
Here you have it.
Okay. Okay, the second question is what content, it is about the same contents, what content would you like to deepen in future? For example, in next opportunities of workshop offered by MedCities. Okay, it seems that the first one is clearly a possible action for energy transitions. Financing sources, I remember someone wrote in the chat that this part was the critic one for implementing actions, and it is. So perhaps exploring more the possibilities of financing or business models can be very interesting and useful. Communication tools. Okay, we are more or less at 50%. Okay, I think we can, this the same number of the previous question have answered, so we can share the results. Okay, so we take this information for next opportunities. For sure, we are trying to, with this session, to explore this item of possible action for energy transition, but for sure communication tool and financing sources are very important to dip in. Okay, and then the third question, I thought it was also with a pool. It refers to your city. So talking about the energy actions that we explore in the previous session, what types of energy efficiency actions from session one you thought were most applicable in your cities? Between, you can choose between, I think you can vote more than one, And so there, we resume them here in 10. There are energy audits, energy management systems, public building renovations, renewable energy production, efficiency technology for heating and cooling, consumer information and empowering, engagement of the tourism sector. Okay, I see that you are answering in different of them. Public lighting energy audits, modernization of public lighting technology, and energy communities. Okay, we have quite different visions, as I see, because there are a lot of different answers. I will share them to you. Okay, more or less the 55%. Okay, the majority of people gave an answer. Okay, so I think we can stop the votation. Okay, it seems that the most applicable one is the renewable energy production. I'm happy about this because we have two examples of this action in this session today. But as I see, you also say that energy management systems, and we have an example of this today. Energy audits, we have also an example. Public building renovations. Okay, efficient technology for heating and cooling, the engagement of the tourism sector. I think this aspect is going more and more important for a lot of countries. Perhaps not for this year, but hopefully for next year. Public lighting, energy audits, and the modernization of public lighting. Okay. It is interesting because we will explore example of more or less all of these actions you said, perhaps except efficient technology. We will talk about more or less or all of them. Okay, so we can stop here. If you have any question or comments, I strongly invite you to write down in the chat or to unmute your microphone. And if not, we can go with the example of today's session. Okay. So I will talk about five main topics. These are energy audit, public lighting, small renewable energy system, scale demonstration and citizen awareness, building energy management systems, and energy communities. Why these five and not all of them? Because of time, but also because these five can be have different aspects of importance. For example, energy audit is very important for the analysis, because analysis is a first step to know which are the highest consumption uses to orient a strategic plan for reduction of energy consumption. Public lighting, even if perhaps it's not always the highest consumption and emission factor for municipality, and it depends a lot on the dimension of the city. By the way, this action can improve not only energy efficiency, but also security and citizen awareness, because it's very visible, one. Okay, then a renewable energy source scale demonstration and citizen awareness, because self-consumption can be a really good solution to reduce energy costs, to reduce CO2 emission, and to guarantee energy security and stability, especially in rural areas. It is also the best way to reduce pollution. Okay, so then building energy management systems, because like energy audit, it is a tool that allows to analyze consumption, detect problems and opportunities. So it helps to develop a strategy for energy efficiency. And then energy communities, I saw that nobody answered this question. In the previous question, nobody said that wants to focus or deepen in this action in future. But I brought you some examples that two examples that can be very interesting and perhaps give you some inspiring cases, real cases. Okay, so the countries where the example are Tunisia, Spain, Morocco, Lebanon, and Cyprus. I tried to represent a bit the reality of people attending this session, and also the dimensions are different from towns to small, medium cities and big cities in order to be quite representative. Fundings, different fundings, these are examples with different fundings, but I have to say that the majority of them depends on European program, like Interreg Med program or Intelligent Energy Europe, the European Regional Development Fund, Urban Innovative Actions. Okay, some of them have also the contribution of the municipality. Okay, so starting from the first one is about lighting energy audit and lighting plan for a municipality, and the municipality is SUS in Tunisia. I think that there is a representative of SUS municipality here in this session, isn't it? Because I will present this first example, and just to say that if there's someone here from SUS, you are more than welcome to add anything you think it is important from your experience and from the particular experience of Mediterranean City Council. So perhaps you can indicate difficulties you had or keys for success or point of views, okay? If you want to stop me in any moment, I don't know who is the representative of SUS here, but I'm just giving you a call if you want to comment, okay? So this project have been realized in SUS in 2019. SUS is a city of 2,030 inhabitants, and it refers to a quite big area of the city, because it was applied to 30,000 city public light points. Okay, these points before this energy audit were for the 20%. High performance lamps, then we enter in detail of this technology, and 80% high pressure sodium lamp. I have to say that both of them are not so efficient regarding consumption and emissions. Okay, the goal for this project was to reduce energy bill due to public light points. So if in that moment, before to implementing the project, the energy bill due to public lighting was 7% of the municipal overall budget and 10% of the total municipal energy bill, okay? So the other challenge is realizing a lighting plan in order to apply this action to all the city, and then to strengthen the capacity of the technical team of the municipality in order to have a more efficient public lighting service. Okay, it was a project of 2 million euro, or 7 million in the currency of Tunisia, and the funding were totally from SECO, which is the Swiss government secretary of state for the economy. This, by the way, the stakeholders involved were different, was SECO, but also SUS City Council, the local affairs ministry, and the group Urbaplan, Transitec, Planair in sites, which gave also the technical part. Okay, so this project was realized within a framework, within the framework of the Integrated Urban Development Program of the city of Sousse. Sousse is a city which is already committed to energy transitions from some years ago, because it is one of the signatories of the Covenant of Mayors Alliance, which we talked about, that we talked about last week. So Sousse is a conscientiated city that is implementing a lot of actions. Okay. To give you a context, this city is working a lot on renewable energy development, especially on applying solar power systems and with ambition programs of energy efficiency and rational use of energy. Okay, so they also have introduced the concept of energy, the action of the energy audit to help promoting low energy consumption also in buildings. Apart from this, so apart from this starting point, they are working on the lighting plan and the reduction of consumption in the lighting uses. Okay, so if we look at the results, apart from the change of the replacement of the lighting points with LED technology, another result is the implementation of the creation of a lighting plan with different energy efficiency measures and with these measures to improve also the night landscape of the city. So the steps for this project began with a starting point, drawing up an inventory of all the fixtures of the street lighting service. After having this inventory, a database was designed and produced. After this database was produced, a technical and energy diagnosis was possible. And after this one, proposal were created. So a proposal to improve the night landscape and also other measures. No? So before of that, training, the technical team was trained in auditing and an in-depth energy audit of the 20% of the public lighting was done. Okay, so the proposal for the night landscape and the measures to reduce operating cost, energy consumption and greenhouse gas emissions were included in the lighting plan. And so after that, guidelines were defined for the future development of lighting. Okay. As regard the technology, as I said, the 80% of lighting was of high pressure sodium lamp, and the 20% was high pressure mercury lamp. These lamps are have a specific color that is like hot color compared to LED ones, which is which has a more cold temperature, cold color. But an important difference is the useful life of these lamps. In fact, the high pressure sodium lamps and mercury lamp have the first one have between 10,000 and 24,000 hour useful life, and the high pressure mercury lamp have a really low useful life of 1,000 to 2,000 hours. Okay, in comparison to LED, which is a technology with more than or with 40,000 hours useful life. So this difference impact a lot on the maintenance costs and on the cost of replacement of the lamps. The other difference is the power, the installed power in order to give the same quality light. In the case of LED, a lower power is required. Okay. And apart from the differences in energy efficiency and useful light life, it is important to talk about the cycling, the turning on and off cycling. In fact, LEDs are an ideal light for purposely turning on and off, and also use sensors, for example, because they respond rather instantaneously to the signal. So there is no warm up or cool down period like in SHP or HPL light. Okay, so they also produce a steady light without flicker, which is better in general for quality light and for security. Okay, so before to enter in the other example, just another aspect to comment is was about the energy audit realized for these lighting these lighting systems. They for the application of the this energy audit, they start from functional lighting. So in this inventory, we say was lighting were collected with functional lighting. So lanes, walkways, parks for different uses. Okay. So then in the inventory also aesthetic lighting and for example, for monuments were collected. And then also public properties whose exterior lighting is managed by municipalities like homes or industrial areas in condominiums. So when we say that an inventory and a database was done, it was done with a number, technology and use, okay? So that the in-depth energy audit could be oriented, okay? I don't know if is there really anyone from SUS who wants to give any comment on this, or if there is any other representative of other city council who wants to give any comment about these kind of examples. Because perhaps depending on the dimension of the city, you can have more or less a good applicability of this action.
I don't think there is anyone from SUS. They were registered, but I cannot see them as participants.
Okay, okay.
But surely if anyone else has any other questions, you can interrupt at any time, or if you want to comment on the applicability of this to your city, or if you have tried.
Yeah, that's it. Is there any city who is implementing action for the public lighting system? And okay, a person raise a hand.
Yeah, Hassan.
Okay, you can unmute yourself, or you can write down what you prefer.
Hello, do you hear me?
Yes, yes, thank you.
Yes, thank you very much for your presentation. What I would like to share with you very quickly is a dilemma we have in Lebanon. You know, in terms of governance, we are not champions, and especially so in the energy sector. This is to say that as municipalities, when we do studies and comparative studies, for example, to find out the recovery period necessary to recap an investment in for example, transitioning or transformation from sodium or light to a light emitting diode, we find it very difficult to recover the investment because the price, in fact, of the energy in Lebanon, as sold to the individuals and also to the municipalities, is very, very low. Mm. So if we want to invest, let's admit it is a priority to invest in reducing energy consumption. We cannot really justify this based on a purely business plan from a financial point of view, because we would need ages and ages before we recover the difference in investment.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, there are some municipalities, of which ours, in fact, because we have two territories. One of our territories in the mountain, we don't even have metering on our consumption. So what the electricity company does is estimate the number or count the number of lamps on the streets, and then invoice us direct per lamp, assuming that it is a forfait. You know, it's a lump sum per lamp that they invoice us. Mm-hmm. So the lump sum is also not very conducive to changing the bulbs, because that would also mean we are navigating without real transparency on our true consumption. So which also means that we would need to put meters that are only available to us to read as an indicator of our consumption, whereas the national electricity company, which is the provider of the energy and by law is the only one, will not admit as a proof of... They will not admit it as proof. Otherwise, we would have to go through them to put the meters. And if you go through them, then it will cost us maybe four times as much. Plus also new cabling systems, because we need to section the tronçon differently.
Mm-hmm.
So it is always a very difficult exercise to do. Knowing that and admitting that, the impact on global, like on the global SDGs, for example, would definitely have us go into a transition. So it's a dilemma a little bit, especially that nowadays we are living in an unprecedented crisis, financially and governance-wise, etc. But just to tell you that, although most municipalities would like really to go that route, change their lighting systems, even managing the lighting, for example, admitting that one third of the lamps should go off, or even two thirds between midnight and five in the morning, for example, especially nowadays that nobody is in the streets or allowed in the streets at night, is also an exercise that most of our municipalities cannot do today, because they don't have the means to do it. Neither the incentives, because anyway, they will be paying the exact same amount when we're talking lump sums, and that would be retrieved from their share of the municipal independent fund. So the complexity is also in the governance and not always in doing the audits or something similar. So this is to defend a little bit the position of the municipalities, who are by and large very much willing to do into the energetic transition, but cannot really find at the end of the day, in the absence of a central government decision that is more into this engagement towards the reaching the SDGs by 2030. So this is just to put you in the loop on some of the difficulties we have, which are not financial, but basically governance related. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your contribution. Yes, it seems that the case of Lebanon you have described is quite complex. So perhaps the suggestion is to try to in this context that is complex to solve, to try to see which are the opportunities to start implementing some of this action, even if it is clear that in this moment for the situation, for the political situation, is not possible to have a good start. Okay, I have thought about something while you were speaking, especially about these different problematics that you have, the one in cities and the one in mountains. I think that in mountains, if you have these problems about metering and the possibility to go through the towards the commercial company, the utility who sell energy, perhaps here the route is to go for self-sufficiency. So using investing in renewable energies in order to satisfy the demand for lighting. By the way, I understand that the problem here can be about the possibility to introduce energy to the grid. Perhaps a specific work should be done about the integration and the legislation for the integration in the grid. And the other thing that I thought it refers to, we will talk about a bit in the next example, is about the recovery period that is so big, so high. I don't know what if you are talking about more than 10 years, for example. Here in Spain, for example, municipalities tries to talk about a good recovery period when we have 5 years, because it is the period or more or less of the change of governments. Depending on the countries, this recovery period can be obtained or not. If not, that is, I think, is your case. It can, and so the municipality is not interested in economically in making this action. Perhaps some different business models can be explored, like ESCO model, which are energy service companies who make the investment and then receive directly the savings during a period, can be a large period of contract. So in that case, even if the recovery period is, for example, 10 years, perhaps these companies can be interested in make this investment. And on the other hand, the municipality can still pay the same quantity can still pay the same quantity for energy consumption, but is emitting less greenhouse gas emissions. I don't know if it is clear, but I will enter in detail in the second example. And I see, okay, indeed, we have to take matters in our own hands, whence the need for innovation is finding financing for self-sufficiency through photovoltaic hybrid solution. Yes, that's it. And I see that there is another message, but it is in French. It's about the city of Chefchaouen in Morocco. Okay, this city has done, I think, an exhaustive energy audit about public lighting. I see. I'm seeing this. What are you saying about this example of Maroc? Because it was one of the examples that I was exploring before this session. I think it was a good one, because in this case, the city did an exhaustive energy audit of 40,000 light points, and then they put it in a geolocalization map. So it was then it was more simple to it was possible to make a control and a continuous analysis of the consumption. And you are saying that it helped to reduce 40% of consumption respect the average, the previous average. Okay, there is another message. Ah, 4,000. Okay, the number is quite lower, but I think it's still a very good example. Perhaps I did not put this example here in this session because I thought that perhaps there was a big difficulty to elaborate this the SIG, the system of geographic information. I thought that it could be a possible barrier for implementing. What is your experience about the implementation of the geographic information system? Perhaps is waiting for traduction. Okay, we can talk a bit more about this. Bénéficier de formation. Okay, you received the technical training for elaborating the geographic system information, and I also see that foundings were arrived from the cooperation with GIS. Okay. Okay. So thank you very much for these comments, and I only want to shift to case two because I have seen the time and I'm a bit scared because it's three and I'm in the first one and I would like to present you eight cases, but it's very useful to have your feedback after explaining them. So I only go to the second one in order to have more comments, okay, after that. These two next examples are still on public lighting. The first one, they are both of them are on refurbishment or replacement of the lighting system by LED technology. But the difference is the first one is interesting because of the business model that I will explain soon. And the second one, because it focused also on safety and energy efficiency problem. It is the second one is in Morocco, so perhaps you know from the city of Chefchaouen. I don't know, or you know it or not. Okay, so the case two, it is a project that it was realized in 2015 in a very small town in Spain of almost 4,000 inhabitants, and it had a citywide area of implementation. It is very interesting because it refers to the refurbishment of the old public lighting system. It is also a project that was more or less totally funded by a program of European Commission. It was an Intelligent Energy Europe program. And I've put here the name of the project, that is a Streetlight EPC project, because I invite you to see to search information about this project that has a lot of examples of different kind of energy performance contracting that are basically different business models for applying these refurbishments of public lighting system. And they are different in different countries. So they can be inspiring for you to find the solution, okay? So this project was realized making an open tender. So the municipality made an open tender in order to search ESCO, which is an energy service company. Okay, so a lot of ESCOs were invited to submit their offers, and then one of them won the tender. Okay, they made a contract, an EPC contract, which is an energy performance contracting contract. This contract was done between the ESCO energy company and the municipality. And it is a 14 years contract, so it is quite large. And it includes the renovation of the street lighting system. So the company made the investment for the street lighting system. Then it also made the energy management service. Within this contract, it includes the payment for energy, the maintenance, and the guarantee for the infrastructure. Okay, we see here that so the type of streets were 85% residential, 15% roads. Okay, the cost savings for thanks to this change were more or less 40,000 euro per year. And the maintenance serving cost savings due to the useful life of LEDs and also to the to the high quality, more or less 7,000 euro per year. So this, in respect to the investment cost of 3,000 euros, this give us a more or less a 6-year payback. Okay, but as I was saying to you, Ghassan, it is a 6-year payback, but by the way, the contract is of 14 years, okay? And generally for these kind of business models, they can be different between different companies and municipalities, but in general, what it happens is that the company make the investment. The company, anyone want to say something? No, it wasn't a meeting. So, sorry, I was saying that in general, the contract functions in this way. The ESCO company make the investment and the municipality or the beneficiary still pay the same cost of energy during some years. So the real energy savings goes to the company, to the ESCO company. And they are the way for the company to have a return on investment. On the other side, the city has a new efficient system for lighting, a better quality, and have reduced their emissions and consumptions. Okay, in general, after some times or after the contract duration, it depends on the kind of contract, the beneficiary, in this case, the municipality, will start to pay less, to pay only for the real consumption. Okay, so to make a quick comparison, in this case, before the renovation, we see that the power installed before the renovation was more or less 3 times more than after renovation, because LED power can be lower than HPS system or HPS technology. Okay, the total number of lamps was increased, so that it is supposed that also the quality of light was increased, as the lighting number points. And here is the consumption is like 5 times less, lower. And the electricity cost, they are also almost 70% lower respect before the renovation. And also the annual maintenance cost is less than 50% due to this energy efficiency of the sensor, but also for the useful life. Okay. There are some comments here. I look to the chat, okay? It is justified by the company's need to make some profit, which is legitimate. Yes. Yes, yes, it is the concept of energy service companies. I don't know if in your countries these kind of business models are have started to be implemented or not, or if there is any, I don't know, legal problem or it is a barrier because people don't trust in this kind of contract. Because as I know, in Spain, they started to talk about these kind of business models perhaps 10 or 15 years ago, but now they are growing a lot. So they need sometimes to be implemented. And then I see that there is another comment.
Berdiana, if you want, I can help with the translation.
Okay.
And it's the ville of Jerba Midun, which is in Tunisia. And it says that they have put in place a strategy of the energy transition during 3 years. And they have reduced the electricity consuming under 50%. And the 80% of it was about public lighting, which was about 3,600 points of light points. And then that they say that for the strategic decisions they made, they change all the lights for LEDs.
Okay.
And also they have like which is telegestion.
The control
yeah, of it.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, we see a similar example. So it is a tendency to start implementing action in energy transition and the change, the replacement with LED is in general it is quite a good solution. If, as we saw in the example of Lebanon, if you don't have the problem of a very low price of energy, in that case, you have to find a different kind of justification, that it's not only about saving costs, but is more oriented on the climate change and the agenda for energy transition, okay? Okay, Ghassan from Lebanon say the model is legally possible through the creation of partnership between the city and the private sector, but the central government is usually reluctant as they tend to protect the monopoly of the EDL, that is the utility company. Yeah, yeah, and in this case, it is clear that it is important to have the central government conscientiated and totally in for these kind of actions. Yeah. And in this case, energy transition for sure need to a political action to convince central government or to find different ways to implement innovative ways to implement such kind of models. Okay, so always talking on the same item, I present the other example of replacement of current lighting systems with LED. And it is an example applied in this case in a big city. It is Kenitra in Morocco, which has more or less almost 400,000 inhabitants. It is a project implemented from 2016 until 2018. And the area of implementation is a district level. It is implemented in the Sacnia district. Okay, this project is an example of projects implemented in the SADEP South project, which the SADEP South project written here in fundings is the SADEP South project is a project who began in 2015 with 12 cities in 6 countries of the Southern Mediterranean. And the objective of this program was to assist local authorities in responding to sustainable energy challenges and to enable them to implement sustainable energy actions. Okay, so in general, SADEP project support mechanisms activities are main focused on different aspects. These activities are focused on the assistance to local authorities to reinforce the capacity, the technical capacities, so giving trainings, for example, and implementing demonstration projects. Also, the promotion for the replication of innovative actions and giving visibility to the projects. Then creation of an enabling environment for the exchange of good practices between project beneficiaries. And finally, the development of their own local strategies. We are talking about the sustainable energy action plans. Okay. So for this case, the project we are seeing here is a demonstration project carried out in this district, the Sacnia district, which is a densely populated district of Kenitra. And this district is characterized by unsafe streets and outdated lighting. So the problem is both of security and of energy efficiency. According for this project, almost 3,000 and a half of light points were replaced with the energy efficient LED technology, and a telemanagement control system was implemented in order to connect until 8,000 light points. So the kind of action is very similar to the one you talked about in the chat for Gerba Midoun in Tunisia too. No? So the impacts of this project are interesting because the first one for sure is the implementation of LED-based street lighting. So the replacement were done in the main streets, but also in squares and the smaller streets. Okay. Then 67 centralized street lighting control devices were installed. Okay. And 8,000 points were connected for monitoring and controlling through this telemanagement system. Okay, and so this, especially this action, increased the capacity of the municipality to analyze the consumption and to implement further sustainable actions, not only for these points, but also lesson learned for applying it in other districts, for example. Okay, so the visibility of this project gave also as an impact the increasing of awareness of inhabitants And then an action plan was created in order to replicate to other districts of Kenitra the project with a bankable blueprint in order to enable the replicability. Okay. And so, okay, I've put it here a question, but I think that we have given a lot of comments on this this kind of action. If you want to add something, or if not, I can go to the other examples that are more on renewable energy sources. Okay, I go to the next examples, but if you want, you can write in the chat. Okay, I'm reading it. So the next examples are specific on the application or the implementation of small renewable energy sources scale demonstration. Always connected with the citizen awareness campaigns or actions. Okay, I will present two cases. One is about renewable solutions for basic public services for municipality implemented in Tunisia. And the other one is a more rural one. So it can be interesting for rural attendees to this session. And it is about bioenergy production in Lebanon. Okay, so I think that also for this case we had a person who was who subscribed to this session from Nabil in Tunisia. I don't know if there is anyone from Nabil here. Okay, in that case I explained the example, and if you want to add anything about your the point of view of municipality is really welcome. Okay, so this example is a SADEP South project too. It is one of the 12 projects that are part of this program that I have explained before. And it is it was paid almost for the 80% by the European Union, and the Binabol municipality from 14%, and from Institute for University Cooperation on Luz for 7.78%. Okay, it was implemented too from 2016 to 2018. It has a citywide area of implementation, but it is a specific to applied to specific buildings or services, okay? And the challenges and goals of this project were to improve the quality of the public services provided by the population, and to address especially three primary needs. One is water sanitation, the other is energetic self-sufficiency of public buildings, and the other one is the energy self-sufficiency of public lighting. Okay, so it can be interesting also for cities who want to implement solutions for self-sufficiency in public lighting. Other challenges were to have a sustainable urban planning towards the growing urbanization and the growth of energy demand. And then to provide replicable photovoltaic solutions. Okay, as we see here, there are different kinds of stakeholders, not only the municipality, but also technical ones like ICU, the Institute for University Cooperation, and GIS, which is the other collaboration of that we saw for the other example in Morocco of Chef Schauen. It was a cooperation from Germany, I think, and other ones. Okay, so also the society la Société Tunisienne de l'Électricité et du Gaz. Okay. So the impacts of this solution were firstly a long-term energy plan in order to address water sanitation, energy self-sufficiency, and public lighting. So as we see, energy audit and energy plan are always the first step. Okay. Then two solar power plants were installed with more or less 230 kilowatts peak power installed. And these photovoltaic panels gave energy for both the wastewater treatment plant, the municipal building energy consumption, and also for public illumination of the area. That was about 10 streetlights. Okay, so the global result was more than 50% reduction of the municipality's energy consumption, but also clean water availability thanks to the functioning of wastewater, pollution reduction as well as a consequence, the increase of technical and management skills of the personnel of the municipality, awareness of population because of this was a visible project, and high replicability for other Tunisian municipalities. Okay, so as I see that Gemma said to me that there is nobody, unfortunately, from Nabil to comment this project. It would be interesting, but I don't know if someone else has other comments, or if not, I will go to the other one on a renewable solution, and perhaps we can make comments after these two ones that are strictly related to renewable energy solutions. Okay, this is a specific to an urban area, and an urban area and photovoltaic system, and the next one is for a rural one and for biomass, biofuel generation. Okay, so we enter in the case five. It is an example implemented in the Koura region in Lebanon from 2015 to 2018. It is a long project. This image show you the map of olive groves in Lebanon, and it indicates the sites where olives are collected. Okay, so the white ones, that are these ones that are white, shapes in the, so these white shapes indicate the most important olive growing regions in the country. Okay, and this example is applied here in the Zgarta Koura region in this area. Okay. We have to say that the agricultural lands occupies the 32% of Koura's region surface. It is a big surface. And the more or less the 90% are represented by olive groves. Okay. And all these groves, olive groves of Koura region represent almost the 20% of olive trees planted in Lebanon. So it is quite a high representativity. Okay, so there are olive groves and there are forest and other wooded and shrub lands. Okay, a lot of presence of a high potentiality of biomass, of biofuel. Okay, so the goal of this project was to install or to create biofuel production from it was the idea was to create biomass briquettes from pruning residues of olive groves and public forests. Okay, but after producing it, the challenge was to increase the biomass use as a renewable energy source for heating purpose as a substitute for fossil fuel. So try to change the source of energy. Okay. The other challenge related to these two was to create a sustainable renewable energy industry related to biofuel production and use of biomass. Okay, so in order to benefit it from the population. Okay, in that ways, the goal was to improve economic status of residents of this area through this new green economy sector created in the region. And of course, raising awareness on renewable energy. Okay, the project here was had a cost of almost 750,000 euro. It is also a SUDEP South project with a funding of 80% funding of the European Union and a 20% divided between the Coura Municipality Union and the University of Balamand. So it is still high dependent on funding, European funding. Okay. The impacts are really, really interesting because a demonstration plant was created, a demonstration plant which turns the tree clippings into briquettes to be used as firewood. Okay, so this plant was constructed. With this capacity, the plant can employ five people, five permanent jobs per shift. Okay, and other employees can be involved too with for the wood collection, so for the tree clippings collection. Okay, so the other aspect is the production of briquettes, then the replacement of fossil fuel heating systems by biomass, and it is interesting to see that with only 1,000 tons briquettes, you can cover the heating energy demand of 85,000 residents. And 1,000 tons briquettes was 1/4 of the availability of briquette of tree clippings of this area. Okay, so another impact was for sure the awareness of local community, and then the reduction of pollution for burning pruning residue. This region was characterized by, or is characterized by, events of white cloud of smoke that is mainly the result of farmers burning their pruning residue. Okay, so after this shift to biomass or biofuel dependence, the reduction of pollution is for sure a good impact in the air quality, and it also reduces the risk of forest fires. Okay, here it is also important the contribution of municipality in penalizing or adapt legislation in order to obligate people not to burn the pruning residue in this way. Okay, so the result is also the potential reduction of 6.8 grams of CO2 equivalent emission through the control of fire risks. So with this example, the reduction of emission is related both to the reduction of fossil fuel dependence and to the spontaneous fires that depend on burning pruning activities. Okay. So as you see, these examples are very different ones. One is for urban and the other one is for rural areas. I don't know if there is someone here that is from rural areas who can see possibilities of adaptation, of application of this example to their case, or have other experience about biofuel production. Anyone who wants to give any comments? Okay, it seems that you can raise your hand or unmute to make questions. Okay, if there is no questions on these two examples, I go on with another one, which is about building energy management system. It is an example realized in Cyprus, in Lakatamia, and it is about the installation of energy saving management system in public buildings with the analytics and the study of investment potentials. Okay, so Lakatamia is a city of more or less 40,000 inhabitants. This is a project done in 2018. And the area of implementation is only two buildings, two public buildings. Okay. The challenge was to reduce the energy consumption and emissions of public buildings, to monitor energy consumption in order to know the highest sources of consumption, to raise awareness on the consumption of public buildings, and for people working in public buildings, and also for citizens. It is a project funded by the Compose Interregmed program, which is another program that I invite you to search about, because it has a lot of interesting projects. And the stakeholders involved are the municipality of Lakatamia, the Technical University of Crete, and the Cyprus Energy Agency, and the Nicosia Development Agency. Okay. What were the steps for the implementation of this project? There was a first part of analytics. So the identification of the needs were done, the selection of pilots of these two buildings were carried out. Then both of the projects realized, both of the buildings, an energy audit was realized. And a priority setting was defined with the municipal council approval. After that, the implementation step was carried out. So the installation of the building energy management system was done, and training and energy awareness activities were done in parallel. And at the end, as usual, the evaluation and feedback. Okay, so the first activity was an energy audit, then for the town hall, a building energy management system was installed, and it helped to identify the most consuming usages and systems of the municipal town hall, to implement controls and automation, and to monitor and optimize the consumption. Okay. Then another energy audit for another building, the municipal multifunctional center, was realized. And in this case, no building energy management system was installed. But investment proposal for renewable energy sources and energy efficiency measures were done. Okay, so all the action realized was done through the declaration of interest and tenders for companies. Okay, and so before to enter to indicators, something about the building energy management systems. This system permitted to measure the general consumption of the whole building, but also with the consumption of floor one and floor two. And it also permitted to manage the localized circuits of the different zones of the first floor. Okay, and so the abilities of this system include the measurement of voltage, current, and power factor, as well as tracking of the energy consumption instantaneously. Okay, then it also allows to collect and download all the data in to Microsoft Excel. And so analytics can be done. Okay, so the idea is to start monitoring and collecting this consumption, and then to define, depending on the result of the analytics, to define the automation's controls. Okay, some sensors were installed and connected to these systems. They were sensors related to occupants and the on-off of lighting systems. So all of these strategies permitted to reduce the consumption. Okay, some indicators were defined for the project in order to analyze the results. And so they are the greenhouse gas emission, CO2, the electricity generated from the renewable energy source that was installed in the, I think in one of the buildings. The fossil fuels saved, the total energy consumption, the energy saved through the building energy management system, which is apart from the one from renewable energy source. Investment and return on investment. Okay. So these results are specific for the building energy management system, but also for other projects. For example, the installation of renewable energy source, photovoltaics. Okay. So the target for this project was to reduce energy demand thanks to the building energy management system by 10% as a minimum, and perhaps growing through the years. Okay. So as we see, these are the results of the first two audits, the one of town hall in the left side and the one of the citizen bureau energy consumption in the right side. So in the case of a town hall, the high consumption of heating and cooling system required for sure a replacement of the heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system. But also the lighting contribution is very high. So lighting replacement with LED was proposed. This building already had a photovoltaic system, and an extension of the photovoltaic system was included. The building energy management system installation too. Okay, in the case of the cities and borough energy consumption, only two proposals were implemented. The one is the replacement of the heating and cooling system, and the other one is the installation of photovoltaics system. Okay, so this is a screenshot of the, it's not so good the quality, but it is just to give the idea of the software that was possible to see for the analytics of the consumption, in order to see the individual the instantaneous consumption for the different uses, and for the in this case is for the town hall, and so the objective was to reduce 10% the CO2 emissions. Other impacts related to this project was related to the training campaign to lead behavioral change of the building users, and the results of conscientiation of awareness campaign for citizens. That this action was done through the website, the official Atacama Municipal website, but also from social media, newspapers, local newspapers, articles, poster, leaflets, and different communication channels. Okay. In this example, we have seen the importance of carrying out an energy audit before to install a building energy management system. And furthermore, training and awareness campaign are fundamental to lead to behavioral change of building user. And this aspect is very, very important for the success of the building energy management system installation, no? In order to optimize the saving. For example, if we talk about sensors and the lighting, or lighting on and off, and the behavior of the users of a building. Okay, so there is a clear connection between these three elements: energy audits for analysis, building energy management system for monitoring, analytics, and control, and the behavioral change that is a need. Okay. Don't know if there is any question. There are any questions about this example or experiences about the installation of building energy management systems in your municipal buildings, or perhaps related to photovoltaics systems? Okay, I will continue with the last two examples, and so we are quite good of time, but then if you have more questions, we can talk at the end. The last two examples are about energy communities, as I said, at the beginning. I hope these can be inspiring for you. And it is quite a challenge, as I saw in your answers, that it was not one of the actions you would like to dip in future, perhaps. And so I hope that they're quite interesting for you. Okay, we will see a case of creation of renewable energy cooperative in the city of Lebanon, and an integrated project on energy communities developed in Spain. Okay, the first one is a project realized in Bakline. It is a city of almost 20,000 inhabitants in Lebanon, and it is a project, a four-year project. It is also one of the SUDEP South project that we described before. It was paid for the 80% by European Union, and the other part was from the Bakline municipalities and from the FMCS. Okay. This project, the aim of this project was to transform this city into a smart city, reaching the European 2020 targets of CO2, renewable and energy efficiency. Okay, the idea was to be economical, social, ecological friendly, and to serve as an actor of change, inciting other local authorities of Lebanon towards signing the Covenant of Mayors, because Bakline was one of the signatures of the Covenant of Mayors. Okay, so it is interesting because to focus on the concept of smart city, because in this concept, citizens are have an important role. They are turned from passive consumers into active ones. And so they have the producer of ideas, contents, application, and activities. Okay, so they also are invited to choose about their society or their reality. Okay, so this concept enhance innovation and creativity, seeking social relevance of new and innovative ideas, opportunities, and also move propensity to entrepreneurial risk. Okay, it is a really innovative concept. Okay. So it has high aspects related to governance, and so we are talking about participatory democracy. Okay. The challenges of this project was to create a smart city, the challenges was to develop and implement sustainable policies and the legislation framework, to create demonstration projects in order to replicate them and to make awareness campaigns, ensuring sustainable street lighting and conscientiation and awareness raising. Okay, so within this project, different actions were realized. The most important were for sure the installation of 32 kilovatios photovoltaic system with the storage batteries in a public building. It was a social center. So this system produced energy for building energy consumption, but also for the lighting, for kilometers of road, and also for pumping drinking water to the 50% of the population. So it is another example where the photovoltaic system was dimensioned with the storage batteries in order to cover three different kinds of uses that are also that make a balance between their profile. Okay, so perhaps the building energy consumption as a consumption profile during the day, but lighting as a profile of consumption during the night, and so making a photovoltaic system with storage batteries permit to cover this profile that is during the 24 hours. Okay. Apart from this action, the replacing of lamps in the street by LED was realized, and the creation of a cooperative of renewable energy was implemented. Citizens and business sectors entered in this cooperative of renewable energy, and then other impacts are the building of capacity, technical capacity for other local authorities, and the creation of communication and visibility plan. Okay, this table is an example of the financing mechanism scenario for the action related to the public street lighting for the change for the replacement of LED by LED. And we see here that in this case, for this part of the project, the outsource finance is only the 20%, and the other 80% was obtained from the municipality with a bank loan with a certain interest rate and 10 years amortization. Okay, so from the result of the total loan repayment, that is 1 million euro more or less, and from the savings that are more or less 2050 euros, we see that the payback time for this case, where the cost of energy is quite medium height, the payback time is 4 years. The payback time is 4 years, but the amortization is 10 years, okay? And with a bank loan of 80%. Then we will say other cases. For example, here are the numerical impacts of this action. The photovoltaic system with storage batteries generated 36 megavatios per year, had a mitigation, and the budget was paid for the 80% by the SUDEP program. Vale. Then also the conversion of part of the water pumping station to operate on photovoltaic solar system instead of diesel, it generates 36 megavatios hour per year of energy with a high mitigation, higher than the previous action, because here it was depending on the system was depending on diesel generation. And then some other action related to the usage of water was needed. So an awareness campaign to enhance the water conservation and regulate the water consumption. Campaigns to the distribution of tools for water savings, like taps, no? Or the encouragement of citizens to collect rainwater. So all these actions permitted to reduce the water supply demand. And after this reduction, a part of the demand was covered by a photovoltaic solar system, okay? This is another example. The example of the financing mechanism for the community hall photovoltaic system. In this case, the 80% was covered by SUDEP financing, and only the 20% was obtained by bank loan. By the way, even if the payback time was less than 1 year, the amortization period is 10 years, okay? So this is the other case. And then another photovoltaic system was installed for the Backlin Natural Reserve. This reserve is one of the most natural protected areas of the region. And so the need for energy in this location will present the overall picture of green areas and reduce the dependence of fossil fuel. Okay, this is also in this case the financial mechanism depending on the 80% by SUDEP financing and on 20% by the bank loan. Okay, I really invite you to search about SESMED project. But I've also put some information from this project for you in the bibliography of this session. But I think it is very interesting because this project is interesting because of the progress. It started with the SUDEP program with these four actions that I've described to you. But then, thanks to this participation to SUDEP program, it helped the city to apply for another project, which is the SESMED. So with the SESMED project, they obtained further financing in order to make other actions. And all of these started by having a strategy, okay? So it means that in the searching for fundings, it is important to have strategies, implement projects, pilot projects, and it helps every time to have to reach more fundings. Okay, I think I go to the last one because we have only 10 minutes, and I want to give you space for some comments. The last project is the Villavat project. Firstly, I'm sorry because we tried to invite the Villa de Cans municipality to talk with you and explain the project by their first hand and first experience, but they could not come. So I will explain for you. I think this project is very interesting because it is it has an integrated approach. It received funding by Urban Innovative Action, which is a program of European Commission oriented to high innovation in urban design. Okay, this project, the city of Villa de Cans has 66,000 inhabitants, but the project related to a district with the Monseratina district with 600 households. This district is characterized by a high level of population, a high density. It has a lot of, the majority of dwellings, of households of this zone are very low energy efficiency and with people at risk of energy poverty or at energy poverty because the economical level of this district is very low. Okay, so the goals of the project was to firstly alleviate energy poverty, then to impulse the deep energy renovation of residential buildings. This aspect is very important because in general, the renovation of residential buildings has no return on investment. So the funding is very difficult and also people in general cannot afford to invest for the renovation. Okay. So the other challenge was to incentivize the private sector to invest in energy renovation and to enhance energy governance. Okay. Here is a scheme of the innovative aspects of the project. So in order to reach this stable energy transition project, the municipality of Villa de Cans initiated an innovative public-private citizen governance partnership, which is this PPCP here in the center. Okay, it is a partnership between public, private, private businesses, and citizen. Okay, so this This partnership is the central hub that manages the new local tools for transitions. And these new local tools are these four one that we see here, okay? So the advisory service is related to energy saving services. So it help to reach the empowerment of citizens and the professional trainings on sustainable construction, energy efficiency, and it was created by creating an information office, okay? Then the local energy operator or which offer energy supply, through the local energy operator, the partnership or who was in the partnership make the an aggregate purchase of energy, so at lower costs, and in this way the it guarantees savings in the cost of the energy. Then the capitalization, these savings were capitalized or are capitalized for investment in energy efficiency and in energy refurbishment. So here is the other tool, no, which is buildings energy refurbishment and renewable energy production through the capitalization of energy savings of the partnerships, of the partnership of the people participating to this partnership. And in the end, the implementation of a local currency based on energy savings. The energy savings coming from the lower price of energy or the energy refurbishment were translated into local currency to use only in local businesses which were part of this public-private citizen partnership. Okay, so it caused the impulse of local economy and it impulsed also the participation of other businesses in the partnership. Okay, so the mission of these entities, these PPCP, is to promote and ensure a secure, clean, and efficient use of energy. Okay, so just to finish, because I think we don't have more time, the innovative aspects of this project are for sure this entity, the public-private citizen governance partnership, which manage these services, and the integral energy operator, which permitted to buy aggregated energy with a lower price, and it helped monetize saving to impulse energy refurbishment. It helped fight the energy poverty, and it is directly translated in local currency. Okay. At the end of the project, 60 dwellings were renovated with a deep energy renovation, a substantial improvement of the quality of life of 600 families was reached, a mindset change among the local population was reached. Then this new partnership or this new entity was an example of energy governance and is still functioning, okay, engaging other businesses and citizens to enter in the partnership. A new energy currency or local currency was created so that all the local sector about energy was impulsed, creating new jobs for the deep energy renovation, and the local economy turnover of this district increased by a 5%. Okay. And so I stop here. It's 4 o'clock. It's we can enlarge a bit, like 10 minutes, if you have time to give some feedback about these questions, these examples, but about your experience. I have prepared some other 2 questions just to understand if these examples are useful, were useful for you. Perhaps we can present it in the pool, or if anyone has a question, you can write it down or talk in the microphone.
I launch the pool.
Okay. Okay, the first question is about this example. Which of these examples is more likely to be replicated in your city? It is very important to us to understand it also for further actions, perhaps to enter in more detail. So, which are the most replicable? Case one, it is a lighting energy audit, or two, refurbishment of public lighting system with the ESCO model, or the replacement of the lighting system we saw for Morocco, or renewable solutions for public services, which is in with photovoltaics. The example of renewable energy for bioenergy production.
Also, in the meantime,
if anyone wants to share their thoughts and say, like, how applicable you think those examples are in your municipality, or if you have tried some of them or you would like to, you can just raise your hand or unmute yourself or write it in the chat.
Okay, I think that more or less the half of the attendees have answered to this question. As I see, I think we can. Can you please elaborate on energy currency? Thank you. Okay. Talking about energy currency, in this project, in the last example. The idea was to create a parallel and economic system, like a parallel currency money, in order to keep the energy saving generated in the district, to keep them in the district, in order to impulse the economy of the district. Okay, so the buildings who received the subsidies for deep renovation from the Urban Innovative Actions, they received some subsidies. These subsidies, they received them in local currency. So they can spend, it was money spendable that they can spend only in some local commerces or businesses that were in the zone. And these local commerces was part of the entity that was created, that was like a cooperative, but was not a cooperative. Okay, so these local businesses who participated in the partnership paid for participating in the partnership, creating like a monetized, like an economic base of this entity. And the movement of money was realized by this energy currency between all the participant of the organization. These are citizens who received, for example, subsidies, or businesses, or other stakeholders. I don't know if it's clear. By the way, there is I think that there is information in the Villa de Cannes website about if you search for VillaVAT project, there are a lot of information on how they approach the creation of this energy currency, because it was a very complicated aspect for especially for the legal way for legislation. Okay. Okay, regarding the results of the first votation, I see that it seems that the example more likely to be replicated in the cities are the one of refurbishment renewable solution for basic public services. It is a photovoltaic system, but also the one related to public lighting systems, smart city, about the renewable energy cooperative, the second one. I'm very happy about this because perhaps this approach on cooperative of energy is important for the governance, and it's very innovative. And it can be a good idea to also to implement project for receiving fundings. And that's all. Ah, okay, Gem, I see that you have put this link. I like for the session one, I've prepared a bibliography for with some information about these examples. So you can read more detailed information and technical one.
Yeah, for now, what I shared with the participants was the slides of the first session, not yet the complementary material, which I will send it once we have everything.
Okay. Okay, I don't know if we want to... Perhaps the answer of the first question was also for the second one, because it was which of the example presented have been most inspiring to you. I don't know if you want to, Gemma, to replicate it, or perhaps we open the turn if anyone wants to give any contribution or comments, and if not, we can stop here.
I can relaunch it if you want, but I would say the answer, it will be quite related.
Okay, while we wait, if anyone wants to give other comments, we launch the second one.
Okay, so here the title is the same, but imagine that it's most inspiring instead of more likely to be replicated.
Yeah. It's
even so if the title is the ideal case scenario. Sorry. In the meantime, let me remind you that after the third session, which will be next week at the same hour, I will explain you about the mentoring process that will take place after these sessions, and to which you can all apply to. So, for example, if you have seen an example that you think could be replicated on your municipality, or you would like to explore a bit more what could be done in your municipality, I really encourage you to apply to this mentoring section where you will have like one-to-one interviews with Verdiana, and you will work in one of the ideas and create like a roadmap. So as you know, if you are participating in the rest of the thematic modules we are organizing, the mentoring sections for the first two are now open and will close. So after the third session of this training module and the mobility training module, which takes place on Thursday, we will also open the mentoring process for the energy module and the mobility training module. So we have some answers already, Verdiana. Do you want me to share them
yes.
now? Here they
okay,
are.
It's similar. The answer is very similar, I think. Perhaps the most inspiring are the one of lighting energy audit, replacement of the current lighting, renewable solutions, and the ones of energy communities. I think it's similar. Yeah. Okay. So thank you very much. I think that this session have been quite interesting. Also thanks to your contributions during the explication of this example. Thanks to your also giving some critical opinion for the application in your case, for example, the example of Lebanon, or also for the examples that you presented of other cases of energy refurbishment of the public lighting system of your city.
Okay, so we can leave it here. Thank you all for your participation. Sorry. Thank you, Verdiana, for the very interesting presentation, and also to the translation team.
Thank you all very much.
And see you all next week. I will send you the reminder, but just remember that the link is different. And yeah, I hope to see you there.
Thank you.